Morning. The topic for today is about middle third fractures. The previous class we saw about the lower one third fracture, mostly about the mandibular fracture. This is the learning outcomes. Just to tell you the anatomy where the lower middle third is from, so you can saw two lines that is drawn at the level of the zygomatic bone which articulates with the frontal bone, and one at the level of the occlusal table of the maxilla. So this region is the middle third. Middle third has got central and lateral. The central one has got maxilla and the nasal bone, whereas the lateral one is called the zygomatic bone. Today we are going to see about the maxillary fractures, which is the middle one third central compartment. Just to brief on with the anatomy, the maxilla is placed at a 45 degree angle to the occlusal plane. So any impact to the maxilla will drive the maxilla posteriorly in the downward direction. So you can see the angle that has been marked at 45 degree. So middle third of the face is the region of the facial skeleton bounded superiorly by the line of the frontozygomatic suture across the frontonasal and frontomaxillary suture, inferiorly by the maxillary occlusal plane. As already mentioned, the plane anatomy, it has got vertical and horizontal pillars and buttresses. The V1 is a vertical pillar, the medial or nasomaxillary buttress, lateral or zygomatic buttress, you can see on the picture, the V2, which ascends up to the supraorbital rim, and V3, the posterior pterygoid buttress, which dissipates force directly down the cranial base. So the horizontal buttress is oriented along the supraorbital rim H1, and then the infraorbital rim H2, and the dental level process H3. So these are more important because these are the one which takes the load or the force when the force has been applied to the maxilla or an impact has been given to the maxilla. So mid-fracture or a structure which can withstand considerable force in the vertical direction but not horizontal direction. Fragile bones can act as cushion for trauma directed towards the cranium for anterior or anterior lateral direction. As already mentioned, 45 degree slope to the cranial base, which helps to get the impact. Low energy fractures can produce similar fracture lines. The causes are road traffic accident, assaults, work related, falls and sporting injuries. The picture shows how a sporting injury can happen. These are the forces that are required to have an impact to create a fracture in those regions. So if you have a fracture in the supraorbital rim, it's going to be 200 grams. If it is going to be the symphysis of the mandible, it's going to be 100 grams. If it's going to be in the frontal region, again 100 grams. Angle of the mandible, 70 grams. For zygomatic and nasal bone, a low force of 50 and 30 grams are enough to get a fracture in those regions. So Rennie Leifort found that there is a series of patterns which are seen in the maxillary fracture when there is an impact in the maxilla, and he came to a conclusion that there are three common patterns that is seen. So, and he classified them as Leifort 1, Leifort 2 and Leifort 3 fractures. So Leifort 1 fracture is an horizontal fracture of the maxilla at the level of the nasal fossa, and the fracture line runs from the lateral border of the piriform rim along the lateral wall of the maxillary sinus, maxillary tuberosity, and ends at the lower one third of the pterygoid plates. So you can see the frontal picture and the lateral picture where the fracture is. So the maxilla is completely fractured and it is hanging. This is the picture. The leaf foot tube fracture is also called as pyramidal fracture. It includes maxilla, nasal bone and medial aspect of the orbits. The line runs across the nasofrontal suture through the lacrimal bones and across the infraorbital rim in the region of the zygomaticus maxillary suture and inferiorly across the line parallel to the leaf foot 1 type but at a higher level. Maxillary leaf foot 3 fracture is called as craniofacial disjunction. Fracture line runs through the front nasal suture around the medial wall of the orbit to reach the optic foramen, infraorbital fissure to separate the pterygoid plates, laterally to separate the frontal and zygomatic suture. So this is the comparison. The shaded one shows leaf 1, 2 and 3. So you can see a floating maxilla will be on leaf 1, a pyramidal form in leaf 2 and total disjunction in leaf 3. This is a pictorial representation of leaf 1, 2 and 3 fractures, how the fracture line runs. This evaluation is more important because to confirm that there is going to be any fracture, this evaluation has to be carried out. So check for laceration, depression of skull, asymmetry, discharge from ear or nose. Palpate the supraorbital, lateral orbital and infraorbital rim, zygomatic body and arch, nasal bone, maxilla mandible, occlusion and for salty taste. So the signs and symptoms which are more common will be the gross edema, bilateral sarcomatous ecchymosis, this is more common in case of leaf 4, 2 and 3 fractures, disc face deformity, case of leaf 1 and 2, posterior gagging of occlusion, leaf 1, 2 and 3, tenderness over the area of bone separation, there can be trismus, case of rhinorrhea, more common in 2 and 3. Nasal skeleton disorganization can be seen in leaf 2 or leaf 3. There can be lengthening of face in all the leaf fractures. You can see clearly how the face is lengthened because of the fracture. If impacted, it can be easily missed because it will stay. Leaf fractures, if it is impacted, it will be easily missed because it will stay undisplaced. Can occur in conjugation with leaf foot fractures, nasoorbital ethmoid, NOV fractures, ZMC fractures, which is zygomatic maxillary complex fracture. It can be unilateral or bilateral. Can be associated with palatal spleen. On inspection, there will be swelling of upper lip, less edema than leaf 2 or 3, increased vertical dimension of face, derangement of occlusion, ecchymosis in the buccal sulcus, beneath the zygomatic arch as the fracture line runs through the those region. There can be palatal ecchymosis, which is called Guerin's sign, which can be seen if there is going to be a fracture 1. This is a picture showing a Guerin sign on the palatal ecchymosis due to leaf 4 fracture 1. On palpation, there will be mobility of maxilla at the leaf 1 level, crepitus on palpation, crack report sound on the So this is a picture, you can see subconjunctival hemorrhage bilaterally, there is ecchymosis. You can see the swelling on bilateral side. So this picture is more clear with some subcutaneous leukemosis, sarcoma leukemosis, and you can see clearly there is left side swelling, which indicates there can be a fracture of zygoma as well. These symptoms are peculiar to, or the clinical signs are peculiar to lymphoid fracture only, step deformity of the infarctal margin, paresthesia of lip or cheek, diplopia and anophthalmos, no alteration of level of eye, mobility at infarctal nasal region, CF leak may be present, intact zygomatic arch. Peculiar to LIFO3 fracture only will be tenderness and separation of the zygomatic suture region, lowering of ocular level, zygomatic arch fracture, mobility of entire face, profuse CSF anuria. LIFO4 fracture is a modification that is added by Robert Marciani, fracture involving the floor of the anterior. And there is a disjunction on the right side of the frontal zygomatic suture. Maxillary fractures, the treatment for them is initial treatment, secure airway, control bleeding, head elevation 40 to 60 degree, consult with maxillofacial surgeon, consider antibiotics and admission. Definitive treatment, surgical exposure, reduction, immobilization and fixation. There are various surgical approaches to fix the maxilla. The mucosal incision, there will be maxillary vestibular approach or transconjunctival approach. Dermal incisions, supraorbital incision, iliotemporal temporal approach, subtarsal incision, subciliary incision and coronal incision. Reduction is done with Rose disinfection forceps. So you can see on the left side the disinfection forceps has got a bend which is used to adapt over without injuring the teeth, whereas the straight end goes into the external nose, whereas the other one holds the palatal aspect. You can see a rubber cuffing so that there is no injury to the mucosa. Reduction with the atemporal enforcer, this is more commonly used if there is a palatal fracture. Fixation is done with direct osteosynthesis, which has got many plates, wires, suspension wiring, which has got central and lateral frontal suspension, circumzygomatic, circumpalatal, infraorbital, piriform aperture, and perialveolar. External fixation is going to be craniomandibular or craniomaxillary. So these are the areas of points of fixation where you can do. If there is going to be a fracture, the lateral orbital rim, zygomatic buttress, you can put a L plate, infraorbital rim and buttress and piriform rim. This is how a frontal suspension is being done. Nowadays all these procedures are obsolete. Very rarely this practiced. So you can see an awl has been passed with the supraorbital incision and it enters into the oral cavity, and then a wire is fed through it and then it's pulled out, and again the awl has been passed through the orbit and the hole is drilled and then the wire is tied. Circumzygomatic suspension through the zygomatic arch, the awl is passed through it, it enters in the oral cavity, wire is fed through it, you take the awl out and then you go around the zygomatic arch through the same incision and then you take it intraorally. Same way you got intraorbital suspension. piriform upper suspension. This is a craniomandibular fixation, a hollow frame or vent which is used earlier before the osteosynthesis started practicing. So these are things which are now no longer being practiced, for your information. Thank you.